I'm going to call us to order at whatever time it is. 5:47 Verizon Standard Time. And.
We might need to take notes.
Oh, so you want me to do that?
Do you want to do that or do you want me to do it?
I can do that. I have, I can take it right on this.
Right.
Okay. As you all know, this is a forum to discuss what we as your local board do about Act 46, because the Act 46 committee ended up in a stalemate, unfortunately, which means that the decision making and the whole process lands back on the local board, which is us. So that said, I was not part of the Act 46 committee, and Flora and Steve were. So I'm going to invite Flora and Steve to sort of carry forward from here. They are by far the best informed.
Do you want me to carry first, or do you want to carry first? Go ahead, say whatever you would like.
Yeah, well, I shared that email with most of you about what our next steps needed to be, and we need to report back as a town, and also decide what we're going to do as a district, if we're going to talk to our neighbors and how to move forward in a positive way to comply with the goals of Act 46. So in my mind, after being part of this process, there's just two options. One would be to justify the way that we are, but that's not for us to decide. We want your input on that. And the second one would be to what we were going to try to do, appoint somebody to talk to the different districts and move forward together. I'll let Stephen speak.
So I have a more specific recommendation.
Yeah.
It's my opinion that this board favors consolidation. I think what we should do is, and I'm looking at the chair, I think we should contact all the other boards and say, is there an interest in pursuing consolidation? Mm-hmm. Because we don't know how the boards feel. Mm-hmm. Well, I think we can suspect how two boards feel by how the vote was. But the other boards were, you couldn't tell. So I think our first step should be outreaching to the other local boards and saying, is there any interest in pursuing consolidation? And if there isn't, then that informs how we go forward. If there is, then that informs how we go forward. But I'm interested in pursuing consolidation. And if there are other boards that are interested in doing that, that's where I'd like to expend our energies. I think Matthew and I were very clear. Matthew was the representative from Doty, from Worcester, that we felt very strongly that this should go to the voters. Mm-hmm. And the voters can vote it up or down, but it's a big decision. Mm-hmm. And to my mind, for everyone that's concerned about local control, we should let the local communities have the control. And we should put together the best consolidation plan we get and put it to the voters. And I suspect there may be a town or two that might be interested in that same process. But we won't know unless we ask.
Can we recap what the talking points or the issues that other towns saw with consolidation or...
I don't know, Flora, can you do that? It would be hard for me to do that.
Yeah, I think there are mainly two issues that other towns, and I also want to open it up to the public since we have public to see their thoughts. Mm-hmm. But so I want to try to be really brief on that. The two main holding points were governance model and debt. So the debt was because we, as especially East Montpelier, but East Montpelier, Rumney, and now Berlin have debt. And when you do a governance model and you unify, that all goes together. We did come up with a potential way to deal with that in an article of agreement, but it hadn't been completely clear for them to be able to move forward. So that is a huge difference. And then the other difference is that they would like to continue to have some of them strongly would like to continue to have their own school boards and take the decisions for the budget themselves and hiring the principal, and they really want to keep everything pretty much as it is, except they want to open up to have pre-K to 12. It had a give like a special unified board the control of keeping pre-K to 12, and you can speak up if I'm missing something, but the pre-K to 12, the outcomes are important for all. Everybody agree that pre-K to 12 outcomes are important. We want all the kids to come to U32 with similar outcomes, so in seventh grade there's not such a disparity. But so, you know, those were the main issues, truthfully. But yes, Tony.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Is there any discussion about if there was a failure of the five schools to come to some positive conclusion that they could bring to the state for review, that the ultimate decisions down the line is that the state, if we don't do it, the state will do it for us. And if anybody were to look at, and when I was in the legislature, they did look at this district as a district that said, that's really easy.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So it was there a thought amongst the other four school boards that they were going to be banking on the law being changed or repealed? Because my little connections that I still have left, that's fantasy. There are too many districts that have successfully done this, and the train has left the station. So I don't really understand why people are digging their heels in the sand, whether it's for good reasons or not. The eventuality of it is that things will change. They won't stay the way they are. Was there
we did talk,
any acknowledgement of that?
Yeah, we talked about it extensively about that, and then there was no, there is some members of even of our community that feel like, you know, the state is never going to come and they're not going to do it and they'll sue the state. You know, we did talk about all of that, so I don't...
For some of the more vocal people against consolidation, that wasn't a concern. For some of the people strongly against it, they are prepared to pursue legal action. I mean, that's... I think what's difficult to say is we can't say, and that's why I suggested what I did at the start, we don't know with the except... We actually don't know what any of the boards think. We only know what certain representatives from towns, some of who are board members, some who are not, thought. We don't know how the boards feel.
And you don't know how the townspeople feel?
Well, not a lot. We know how some, we've heard from some towns, but we don't know collectively what the towns think.
I think we know more about how, in my mind, how boards feel, because you can get a sense by the representatives of how their local school boards feel. Even though it's a representative, they're still, you know, representing their town. But we really don't know what you're saying, how our towns feel. We got a sense at a town meeting this year, really for the first time, more clear about. But we don't really know unless we go out to vote. But you've had a comment.
Yes, I have a question. I'm just wondering if any of you could speak to why a supermajority model was chosen as opposed to a supermajority, if you want to bring this to the voters.
That's what the committee decided to operate under.
Yeah, and it started truthfully, and we had this go back and forth in the committee. It started because we originally wanted to start with that consensus model, and then you know, facilitate and do all of this, and then we slowly started to put, you know, boundaries and said, well, if you're not going to have a supermajority, this can't, that it would require a supermajority to go out. So in theory, everybody was going to be in a better, all the communities were going to have more buy-in into it. And at the end, you know, I, from my personal point of view, I didn't even want to call a vote. I was hoping that we would be able to just move forward and say, you know, I'm 70%, but I'm not going to stop this. We're going to come up with some kind of model, put it out to the voters, and it still come from us. Instead of, you know, a completely, you know, disbanding. But yeah.
But that was the model that was adopted at the first organizational meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I also think I'm talking too much, but I also think that one of my main interests would be that we preserve that we do a good job with U32, and I would hate for us to try to pit our towns against each other right now, but you know, how do we move forward together? I know we just tried to do that and it didn't quite work, but it wouldn't be in the best interest, I think, in my mind, to try to just get, you know, two towns together and the other three not to get, you know, it just seems like we would be, you know, separating everybody in camps when we're already collaborating together so much better than we have done in years before.
So, again, I'm asking a question. It appears to me, maybe I'm wrong, you'll correct me if I'm wrong, that from what I heard about the big fear was that having a local school board be responsible for their school, that basically nobody could do it better. Okay, so I understand that. But was there, you know, I can't, you know, when I look at the model, if you go to the consolidated model and you have an expanded larger board that's responsible for the six schools at that point, I can't for the life of me imagine that there wouldn't be, you wouldn't be called a school board maybe anymore, but maybe you would be called a council. Mm-hmm. You'd have to exist to collect the data, collect the information, share the what the environment is of the school to move it to that central. Was there any talk about that and why that was not acceptable?
Because the councils would be
didn't have budgetary control.
Yeah, they didn't have statutory powers, so they would be advisable. So the councils would be advisable, and even though they can be doing more for the schools, we were not able to get enough buy-in into the council model because you don't have statutory powers. Yeah, so you can say, you know, whatever, no to the budget, to, you know, you don't have the ability to hire the principal. That's one, for example. We did look at different ways that you could elect a council, what the council's responsibilities would be, but there was not enough buy-in for that model.
Correct me if I'm wrong. The superintendent hires the principal today, is that correct? So
yeah.
The school boards don't,
it would be the same,
hire the principal anyway.
No.
So that,
and actually the council model will give us a better way to connect with the principal than the board does now. But yes.
What I thought was fascinating at the last meeting I went to, which was I think the next to last one, mm-hmm. Before the plug got pulled, and that was the first one where the lawyer was present. I thought that was really profound, the extent to which members of the committee didn't know what the law was. There was incident after incident where they would say, well, we want to do this. Well, that's not it. That's against the law. You can't do that. Mm-hmm. And it could have saved a lot of time, I think, had we had legal advice earlier, mm-hmm. so that people would give up some of their fantasies about what they wanted to do, which wasn't allowed under the statute. And they were kind of taken aback when they heard some of this, and then started saying, well, we got to change the laws then, because they won't let us do what we want to do.
Sorry, not you.
It was disturbing to me to watch that play.
I would take a different read on it.
Yeah.
They knew all along it was against the law.
But and I don't.
For the people that opposed, they weren't surprised.
I think, you know, we wanted to see the we wanted to hear everybody's fears and everybody, like, really have an honest conversation and have those conversations, because those conversations were happening before, but in the parking lot and not actually there. So we were able to have those conversations in, you know, and bring the lawyer into it. I think that people were reading more into the alternative options, and they were hoping that through that alternative they would be able to do things differently. So part of the idea of having the lawyer there was that, to try to give bounce ideas, but bounce ideas from him and see how much we could bend the law to work for our five districts. But there was not a lot of room. The only room we found was that article of agreement to maybe preserve the debt separate. But other than that, there was not as much. So
is the next legal step, I thought I heard, was that you have to at least enter into a discussion with at least one other school in the district. And I heard you say that you think Worcester has the same mindset as this school.
I know the representative from Worcester felt very strongly that he wanted it to be able to go to a vote.
Okay, so my suggestion would be is to whatever school it is in the district that either wants it to go to a vote or is more on the flavor of the total consolidation and not bother with it with anything else, because anything else won't be acceptable to the state. Anyway, why not just do that, and that you've met the letter of the law, wash your hands of it, and say, okay, we've done our gig, and now we'll wait and see what happens.
I would say
to
that
to be a little less passive about that, personally speaking.
It would be
a
political answer. I think I'll speak for myself. I, particularly through the first 6 months of information that was shared, I felt very strongly that this was the best model to pursue. I felt like this would have provide the best opportunity for students. And that's what's driving my work. So feeling that way, I feel like I need to at least personally exhaust every opportunity to move in the direction of what I think is best. Now, that may not be what the majority thinks, and that's okay, but I would like people to be able to weigh in on if that's how they think or not. So for me, there's a lot of angles you can approach it at, but for me personally, I truly believe that this is the best model going forward for student learning. And others disagree vehemently, and that's okay, I understand that. But I think it's due its fair discussion in the communities. Let the communities hear what are the advantages and disadvantages of both and decide what they want to do. So it's not, for me, it's not just meeting the letter of the law and moving on. Because politically, I agree with you. I think we're going to be consolidated. I would just like to have as much of our input into that process. And I'm not against that consolidation. So I'm not saying let's get our input because that's going to be our only choice. I want that direction. But that doesn't mean I want the state saying this is how we want you to do it. I want that direction with us saying this is how we want to do it.
I'm going to follow up, Stephen, kind of point this at you. What are you expecting to happen at the joint meeting at the end of April?
There is no joint meeting at the end of April.
You don't have a carousel meeting then?
Not until June.
But we can ask for a special meeting.
We could. There's nothing scheduled right now.
Standing
so there's nothing anything from now until your next board meeting in May.
But, well, you know, part of, we can't be that passive about what's going on. So part of the idea of meeting today is trying to move that process along, either reappoint
a
member.
That's why we have a special meeting tonight.
See, I thought you were
waiting
now
until
because
May.
Everybody was going to get together at the end of April.
But we talked about the possibility of that at our full board meeting. So, you know, in my mind, I would like to be able to, and we talked about this, to appoint somebody that can be having those conversations with the other boards so that we continue to move this work along. You know, I agree with Stephen. I tend to be a little bit more cautious about listening to that other side, because I had also it didn't come like naturally. You know, like, oh, woohoo, you know, Act 46 is here, we're going to consolidate and, you know, and have a unified board. So it slowly came, you know, for me, without the councils, there's no, you know, but that's just personal, you know, just because I feel that it's really important to make that. So the devil is in the details. So having good articles of agreement between all the towns. So I can't just say, you know, I think we're doing better and better modeling what centralized leadership looks like, you know, so it's lower to a lot of people that haven't been on the board for quite some time to see what, there's a lot of things that we already do together. So the devil is in the details. So we would have to just I worry about putting something out that says, you know, which option would you favor as a town. I think we really have to have a plan out that doesn't just merely.
Well, we could not put an option out. It would be,
yeah,
this is what we recommend, and you vote yes or no. It wouldn't be pick A, B, or C.
Yeah, we can't do it. Yeah.
We could, but that,
you know, if
and you get 36%, 41%, and 28%, and what does that mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think if we're going to move together and we're going to have a good unified system, we have to figure out a way that we can move forward together. You know, even if we're going to bang our heads against the wall for a little longer, there's got to be a way that either, you know, I know that there's a lot of people, and I hate to bring this up today, but there's a lot of people that disagree with having a unified model, but really want to talk to Montpelier, for example. So, you know, is there any other things that we can think about that really will shake the process a little bit and allow us to move together? I really don't want to push this down the throat of anybody, just say, like, you know, Wister and I are going to get together and this is what we're doing.
Floor is very optimistic that we can work together to find a solution, and I'm very pessimistic that we can work together and find a solution.
Well, I kind of think the history of the last 18 months, there was a lot of work and a lot of emotion.
And this is not about the data, you know, we're all sitting here. This is not about the data. This is about perception, and it's visceral, and it's our towns, and it's our schools, is how we, you know, how we interact with each other. So it's just, you know, this conversation needed to happen a long time ago, before even Act 46 passed, you know, but we're not going to get into that. But we need to. That's just my personal.
So you said there are people that are opposed to our own towns merging but want to talk to Montpelier, who has a single board for all three schools.
Yeah.
And we would have even less representation.
Okay.
Because they would have more population and they don't own their schools. So there's.
I mean, I'm not.
That's a reinforcement that it's not about the data.
Right.
It is not about the data. But it makes sense too. You know, we're at Donut, they're in the middle. You know, it doesn't make any sense to not collaborate. But yes.
Can we look it up on the other end in terms of the scenarios? How could this play out? So my understanding is if the SU, the five towns, voted on the preferred or an alternative model, and we brought that to the state, the agency of education, they might approve that.
Yes.
Likely they would approve that. That seems remote at this point. So at this point, either the SU or the five towns or some combination of the towns are to bring a report or multiple reports to the Agency of Education demonstrating how we comply with the goals of Act 46. Mm-hmm. The likelihood of us coming with one report that demonstrates that is I mean, we've already been told that we won't be able to produce a report that complies.
Right. Mm-hmm. This model does not, the AOE has examined this model and said at the very beginning of this process that the model that we're in would not be allowed.
And our five towns appear to be divided. That might not be true, but we only have 6 months or so to come up with a direction. So is there any...
Can I just interject something? We don't have any idea how our towns feel. Representatives from towns that were on the committee had certain
that's
beliefs.
An important distinction to make, I think.
That's why I made it.
It's important, but we have to in some way involve these representatives in building consensus into one model. I mean, it seems hard to work without them. So my question is there any scenario here that's at all likely that has us bringing something to the agency where they're just not going to make the decision for us? A report that demonstrates compliance or a vote on a model that they will accept.
Yeah. Those are the only two options. To present an alternative, we have just until November of this year, the 30th of November of this year, unless S-122, which is now passed the House and is now in the Senate, will extend that timeline until January 31st of next year. So our timeline is really short.
Laura, do I remember sometime in the last month or so that the legislature addressed the issue of debt?
They're addressing it again in this S-122. It hasn't passed, but they are addressing debt, and they're addressing, there's like seven different sections, but the timeline and the debt would be the two that correspond to our district, but there was a lot of pushback from that. I was there last Tuesday. And there's a little pushback from other towns saying that, this just benefits a select group of towns. It's not something that benefits everybody.
Isn't it true that if we were able to bring a consolidation report forward, that we in East Montpelier could decide, the town could decide that debt of this bond was, quote, the big issue amongst the other, that we could keep that separate and keep and in some way, shape, or form keep paying for it as we're committed to pay for it for the next 20 years anyway?
Our lawyer, Paul Giuliani, said that he thought he was not absolutely certain, but he thought that we could do that we could keep it separate through an article of agreement. What is now on the Senate is a little bit of both, so it could benefit us, but it could also harms us because it would be keeping the debt in the town. And right now, that's what Montpelier does. We own our schools, and it's part of our expense, our educational. That's what we get hammered. So we would want to keep. Would want to continue to have that benefit. So having an article of agreement is more beneficial for us, and being able to prorate that. But we're not gonna solve the debt.
Did that make sense?
Tonight.
Did everybody get that distinction?
I think too, and we did hear this from Giuliani, there's some flexibility. So there's no cut and dry rule in Act 46, how the debt is shared. The only solution that's been presented is to consolidate the debt and equally distribute it amongst the communities. I bring it up because I was someone that opposed East Montpelier keeping its debt totally. I was willing to say it would be too much of a burden to share it equally. Mm-hmm. But my stance was, if you expect me to share some of your debt in the future, I expect you to share some of our debt today and come up with a formula that towns could say, so a town that didn't have debt could say, well, I don't want to increase my debt, but this is an unreasonable increase, and I have protection in the future when our school needs some work. It's going to be affordable because it's going to be spread out over this larger group. And for us to have debt could say, gee, I'd like to see it all shared and have ours go down, but that's not fair. Maybe ours goes down a little bit, and so in the near term, we benefit from it, but we assume the risk in the future of schools that haven't had work done, that need work done, we're going to contribute to that and find that tipping point where
we can't afford
everyone it. Was like, yep, you know, we're willing to accept these other towns' debt at this level as a protection against our future debt, and we're willing to say we'll take the benefit right now, understanding that we're going to see an increase in the future.
I'm not a resident, and I swore I'd keep my mouth shut. But on the debt thing, I did want to inform you that what's in, I think it's point H509, mm-hmm. that pours the debt onto the town, which means that that goes onto the town taxes, and you don't have income sensitivity on that side of the taxes.
So that's the other part that wouldn't work for us.
Right, so there's two pieces of that. There's the income sensitivity piece, and there's also the fact that it's counted as ed spending or not. So it affects the spending for equalized pupil formulas and all of that.
Yeah.
But it says may, not shall, because I remember reading that language, so there is some room for interpretation. But you would be the expert at that, Tony. So.
There's some other towns in the state that are very, very upset about it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't imagine anything like that would fly anyway,
so,
to completion. But was there any, you know, the debt could go to, you know, one of the scenarios I envision that could be a possibility with the consolidation is that you have elementary school choice in the district. And when residents of any town can choose to send their kids to any of the existing elementary schools in the district, that kind of softens the debt issue. Was that a fear of some of the schools who seem to not want to consolidate, that maybe enough parents would say, well,
So I can only bring my perspective. I think people on the committee had positions from day one,
yes,
and they were not going to be swayed. So any of the discussions it was difficult to get to substantive discussions on the different possibilities. Does that make any sense?
Yes, because you're absolutely right. I think it was 3 years ago, and I don't know whether it was a U32 school board meeting that I was at as the representative, but it was the beginning of what Act 46 would be about, and they went around the room. Maybe it was the first. It was the first district. You were there, right? It was the first district-wide meeting, and I distinctly remember the member from Worcester, a gentleman, saying, "Well, I'm not going to do any of this stuff because the only thing I'm interested in is repealing this." And I remember saying to him, "Well, you know, it is the law of the land, and you're supposed to roll your sleeves up and do the best that you can. And by the way, repeal is never going to."
He was not on the study committee. That was the early.
Oh, that was the. But I remember that.
I remember that.
So you're absolutely right.
So how many representatives per community were there on the committee?
It depended. It was proportional. So East Montpelier and Berlin each had three. Callis and Middlesex each had two, and Worcester had one.
And what
were
the? And
they
had a
non-voting member too.
The way the vote went was the East Montpelier group, and Floor, correct me if I get the vote wrong, the East Montpelier group all favored consolidation, the Berlin group all opposed consolidation. The one board representative from Worcester favored going to a vote, and the Callis board members favored going to a vote. The community member did not favor going to a vote.
Yeah. Or so consolidating. At the end it was 6-5. So 6 favor consolidation, mm-hmm. 5 didn't want to consolidate. So it was not a supermajority. Yes.
Do you have a sense of, I'm sorry if I missed this earlier, but if the reports are likely to be, say, 3 out of 5 towns are going to make the case for It's great the way it is. Even though they've been told that it's mm-hmm. not going to conform. But is that kind of your sense of the status quo as far as reports being submitted?
We haven't had those conversations, so it's, you know, it's hard to tell. I think that, you know, I come at this a little bit different. I think that some people had some legitimate concerns about, you know, school closure. You know, like there's a lot of things that they had kind of in the back of their mind that even though they favored going to Unify, they were worried that, you know, at the end the only savings is in school closure. So it's really hard to say what. You know what, I know that there's some talk, because I've seen some emails, there's some talk about, you know, just trying to do the status quo or stay in the towns. And then there's the letter about joining Montpelier. You know, I think everybody's going in all sorts of directions. So ideally, we would try to bring all that energy together.
I think it would be fair to say we don't know
yeah.
at this point what boards are going to do.
School closure, you could have addressed in the articles.
Yes, and we said we wouldn't close for five. You know, it's just we didn't really were able to get to the details at the end because there was no agreement on governance.
So you had said earlier that part of the concern about consolidation was carrying the debt over. But I thought you said Berlin was one of those schools that has debt that would.
So it's
they, didn't have it
they just passed the button.
So I want to be respectful, but I want to express. So this is personal, and I said it earlier when I was answering Tony's question. I think what made this committee, the Act 46 committee, hindered the work of the Act 46 committee is I feel that members of the committee had positions from day one that they were not going to sway from. So no amount of information, no amount of anything was going to sway some of the committee members. They were determined to oppose it from day one. Now that's just my feeling. It's just my impression from the way things went, but that's what I believe. And I believe that's what led to that committee being ineffective.
But I think it goes both ways, you know, because we were doing a unified, so, you know, as much as the ones that wanted to oppose it had made up their mind from the very beginning, the ones that were sure that this is the best model had made up their mind from the beginning. So there was no crossover, you know, there was no, like, let's try to compromise and come to the middle. You know, we were like slowly getting there. We didn't get there, you know, in cold votes. So there was no movement from either side. I understand that Act 46 is for Unify, but you know what I'm trying to say, you know, there was no, there had to be some interaction between the two sides, and trying to come with those councils, I thought, oh, you know, that could move us to the middle, but maybe it was brought too late into the process. Thought about it, you know, I don't know, but I think, you know, just to be fair, I'm not trying to put that on you, but to be fair, there, you know, there it needs to be movement from both sides. Not that that means that we go to an alternative, but a truthful acknowledgement of the worries of the other side.
Yeah, from my perspective, and I wasn't on the committee, but I, you know, was paying attention, the opposition to consolidation seemed to be based on two principles. One was the debt issue, which is complex, and I understand, but I also think it was workable. I mean, mm-hmm. we might not have started looking at, you know, real solutions until near the end or something, but I think we could have gotten through that. The other piece was just the very principled position that local control, whatever that means to people, and smaller is better, and this is a, you know, a government mandate that's being handed down to us, and we're going to fight it. That's not anything that I think that you were going to be able to convince anybody, or any amount of data was going to convince. That's just a
yeah, it's,
very
it's,
principled
it's
position.
Visceral. It's just continuing to have those conversations with people, you know, slowly, and I don't know if Doc can speak to that, you know, people, I felt like people were slowly starting to get there, and unfortunately we ended up with the three members of Berlin still voting, you know, against that, because I think that, you know, they were hoping that we would do an alternative. So it's is not easy, but we have to figure out how.
Yeah, I mean, if I can interject, and I'm not trying to squash the discussion, if people have questions, ask them. I'm more interested on what we're going to do going mm-hmm. forward and less interested on what's happened over the last 18 months.
Yeah.
So if I could, just following up on, so if we believe that there's not really a scenario where we can present something to the Agency of Education that they will approve, maybe the best we can do is try to influence their decision. And one thing we might try is to start with some principles with this board or this community that we have, and advance those principles, you know, just a set of statements that, about things that we believe that we want to see in whatever the agency decides, and try to build some support from maybe Worcester, maybe other boards, and maybe individual board members, or however we want to do it. So things like, we believe a consolidated model will be better for the SU, if that's what we believe. Some sharing of debt would be beneficial for the SU, if that's mm-hmm. what we believe. And, you know, try to build some momentum and invite others in to share those principles if they do. Because it's hard for me to see how we're going to be able to advance something to the agency where they say, okay, there's just not time, and I don't know that there's the will either.
I think along those lines, there is a body of work and a body of knowledge carried around in a handful of heads that have worked very hard on this for the last 18 months. And I would like to see that collaboration between boards, just personally speaking, continue. I think it's there's two sides. So there's the one side that says, well, if we want to show just how inefficient the five board system can be, then we can all go off into our separate corners and we can all do exactly the same work between now and November. And that'll be a beautiful case in point of what a ridiculous way this is to do a common shared task. Or we can choose to actually adopt whatever version of this model we can, to the degree that we can, by having those heads that have been working on this issue and have done so much work collaborate and continue to do so, and perhaps start building things like those shared values and shared statements that then come back to the town, that the voters of the towns can weigh in on and say, yes, we think those are valuable and we stand behind those and we agree with them, or we don't. It's very frustrating to me on a personal level that any board member who is a representative of the town would refuse to have an issue come to the town. That's my personal take on it. I think as a representative to the town, sometimes it's our job to lead, but never is it our job to not give the voters an opportunity to weigh in.
Should we put a survey out about, you know, do you want to have a vote on this, since we don't
there
have a model?
Something to vote on.
Well, we don't have anything to vote on. I think tonight we've called a community forum and we've asked for community input. So I would ask, as community members, how do you feel about what
years ago when I was on mm-hmm. school boards, and can't imagine this has changed. There was prevailing thought that the best educational model for our sixth graders was that they really need to be out of the elementary school by the time they're done with fifth grade, and having a real middle school, a 6, 7, and 8, would be beneficial to all kids educationally. If that is still a continued philosophy or mindset, what does that do to the, if the five elementary schools were now sending their sixth graders to U32. What does that do to the viability of the five schools staying as five elementary schools?
So that was part of the study, that was part of the efficiency study that was done, and the efficiency study said that if that's the model we went to, Calais would close.
And Worcester.
No, Worcester
would
not
close.
Well,
Worcester could stay open.
Worcester can't close because there's not enough space.
Because there's not enough.
Not enough space at Romney to take in the Worcester group.
If we were a consolidated district, Worcester kids could go to whatever elementary school.
Well, but the efficiency study didn't address consolidation. It addressed efficiencies. And if all students went to, if we had a true 6, 7, 8 middle school, we reduced all the elementary schools down to pre-K through 5, and it didn't say Calais had to close, but Calais could close. There was space.
The only way there were savings is if Calais closed, and it created a more efficient, more opportunities. That's right.
Was there a specific school that each, so like you said Calais would close, would that mean they'd be absorbed here or here in Worcester?
They would be absorbed primarily here. Because we have excess space.
And I think there are two sort of overarching pieces to Act 46. One is student opportunity. And if you read the letter, don't tell any of you this, but the law specifically addresses educational opportunity. It has very little to do with cost. And so in following the spirit of the law as it's written, we're really not talking about cost savings. And I think there's a little bit of a red herring at work where there are a lot of people focusing on where the money is and where it's going to come from and what it means and how it all flows and what's it going to mean to my taxes. But at the end of the day, that's not what Act 46 was really authored to do. It may have been sold that way, which is deeply unfortunate. But reading
the
law.
But the efficiency studies that we made, we were looking for efficiencies. So we were looking for savings.
That was pre-Act 46.
Off to the side and had really nothing to do other than a coincidence of time with Act 46.
Yeah. Back to that hypothetical list of core values, I would put equality of opportunity right at the top.
And I think that, and we may be in the luxurious position of being able to sort of feel that way about other students. I don't know that other communities necessarily feel that way, but we, again, all right, I feel very strongly that that it is all of our kids. You know, I mean, my kids go to school with Worcester kids, and they all come together in the same place come seventh grade. So why, right, they have extracurriculars together. I mean, they're in summer camps together. I mean, that's... It's not that big a place that our circles don't intersect almost completely. So again, this is one of my personal frustrations, is this idea that these Venn diagrams are like these five circles with these little tiny intersections. It's just not the way it really works.
Adrian used to talk to us, I was on the U32 board, about 90-90-90 schools that are 90% minority, 90% low SES, and 90% meeting the standards. And we're here with, at best, 60% meeting the standards and next to nothing in terms of minority and very low SES, relatively low compared to 90. I think we're complacent. I think we're not really looking hard enough at how much better we could and should be if we were putting our energy in the right places.
So how are we going to move forward?
I want to add one thing to what Ruben said.
when you talk about the five, always remember that there's a sixth one. And if you're going to talk that way, you should include the sixth.
Speaking personally, I completely agree. I think it's absurd that we have a district with a big hole blown in the middle of it. And that we drive buses through.
We got to get our stuff together first before we can entertain that.
Well, I don't agree with that.
And so, personally, what I would like is to have some representation from this board, town, whatever, who is charged with reaching out to and collaborating with willing parties on the other boards, including Montpelier. Right? Like, let's talk about it and figure it out.
It won't be a first.
Good.
It won't be a first for sure.
So just so we're clear, right now we're prevented by statute from reaching out to Montpelier.
Right.
Because they're involved in a 706B, which prevents them from discussing with other districts. They're only permitted to talk to Roxbury until their 706B committee is resolved.
Yeah.
So right now, we're prevented from by statute from outreaching to them to consider consult.
They're prevented from speaking to us.
Yeah.
I would presume that we're not prevented by statute from doing that.
Okay, they're prevented from talking to us.
Yes, yes.
I agree.
But again, to go back to how I started the meeting, I think there's uniformity on what we feel. I think we should express that to the other boards and ask if there are other boards that feel the way we feel and are interested in pursuing those goals.
And how would you do that? Board chair to board chair? How would you do
That's
that?
What my suggestion was at the start, but.
And frankly, my hesitation to that is that I have not been involved with Act 46, so I'm willing to do it, but I would be much more comfortable if another representative from this board who was on the Act 46 committee.
Well, it could be decided that someone else outreached.
Was.
But we would have to be clear on what it is that we want others to, that we're interested in. They're inviting others to talk about. And if no one's interested, like I said, it informs how we move forward. If there's interest, it informs how we move forward. But I felt like our boards had a clear understanding, except perhaps new members that haven't been able to participate, so of where the committee was going, got pretty regular feedback on our stance, and was our stance the stance of the board? Was our opinions the opinions of the board? And so I felt like we were, we had a certain a unified approach throughout the process. And if that unified approach continues to be, we would like to move in the direction of a consolidation and see if we can create, that we liked the possibility of consolidation and we would like to write some articles of agreement to present a proposal to the community. I do not think without some kind of leadership and some kind of proposal that we'll ever move forward. We'll talk. And look at you, because we feel differently about
approach. I don't feel different about, you know, moving forward. I think I very much want to move forward, but like they say, and this is new to me because I've come from places that, you know, that's how you have dictators. Democracy is low, you know, like it doesn't matter how, you know, and that's the part that I love about not being here. It takes a little while, and there's so much that you can put down somebody's throat that you need buy-in. You need buy-in for it to move forward. You know, you need buy-in from the community. So I'm not saying let's not do it, but let's make sure that if we're doing it, we're doing it in an inclusive way of all the town, so we're not pitting each other against each other. I think we have to move forward together, whether it is that we move forward with a model of unified model, so we move forward and say we're going to justify what we have, take our chances, and they're going to say no. you know, because that might be what some boards wants us to do, so we would just go with an open mind.
I think we can, I think if those boards want to do that, they are free to do that at this point, right? The Act 46 model, the 706B committee wasn't able to gain consensus, which means that if there are boards who want to try that model, they are welcome to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not willing to follow that plan. I don't think it's a good plan from an educational perspective, and I don't like being not the master of our destiny. I'm not willing to be play a passive role. So that says to me, and here's what I suspect will happen. A subset of the folks that have been working on Act 46 for so long will start to collaborate, and it will be a genuine collaboration, and there will be a different model of consensus building and such, and there have been heavy lessons learned in that committee, and it will be a much more functional group.
Yes, I agree.
And what will come out of that is a healthy discussion around a problem-solving discussion around the actual issues, instead of everybody being lined up behind whatever hedgerow they decided that they were lining up behind. And when that work starts to move forward, first, it will show the agency of education that we are taking deliberate steps to not thumb our nose at the law, to follow the law, which I think is really important, because at the end of the day, the law is the law. And if they decide to come in and say, you are a district, then they will, I hope, be kinder to those of us who have been working diligently toward some sort of a model that makes, that fits their requirements. I think in a hopeful way that if some of the other towns that have been reluctant to join see these substantive conversations happening, they may actually come to the table slightly later and with a different stance. That's my hope. And that at the end of the day, we will land where we're all trying to land, where we're going to land. Like, I mean, and this is my opinion, but Rebecca Holcomb was really clear. We're going to be consolidated.
Yes.
So we can bury our heads in the sand and pretend like that's going to happen, or we're going to sue, or we're going to draw this process out for years and years and years and years and years. But the reality is that even if that happens, we're going to be consolidated in the meantime, because that's the law. So even if somebody was able to prevail in a court of law years down the road, are they going to tear it apart once you've got a functioning consolidated district? I think not.
No.
So,
and we have agreed to do that. When we sent the letter to Rebecca that we were disbanding, we said, you know, we look forward to continue to collaborate and comply with the goals of Act 46. You know, it's not like we acknowledge that we want to. So I agree with you, both you and Stephen. I understand that we need leadership. All I'm saying is that we need leadership, but we need to continue to talk together. So that was the interest. I felt like, for example, Chris, it was his idea. Chris and somebody else talk at the full board meeting. They came up with the idea of, you know, having the boards come together, whether it was appointing a representative of that board and continue to, you know, move forward together. And I agree with Stephen. So if there's three boards that say, you know, we need to continue to move this together, and then get input from there, from them, of how we continue to move in that direction.
So
where's the optimism? I mean, I hope you're right, but
yeah.
I was at that. I listened at that meeting, and I was like, man, I didn't know where Chris McVeigh was coming from. Okay, with his statement after being one of the rigid opponents of the whole thing. So where does your optimism come from? What's it founded in?
I think there is optimism.
I think I am a hopeless and eternal optimist, just in general.
Okay, so it's not
It's not based on anything. It's not based on any interpersonal conversations or any. I think it's really, it's like an outsider's 1,000-foot view of this. If you take a step back and you look at the inevitability of it, then it becomes, and you take the emotion out of it, then the choice becomes clearer. You can be passive and it can happen to you, or you can be active and it may still happen to you, but at least you've had a hand in what happens. And that's where I want to be. We the ship has sailed on holding hands and singing Kumbaya at this point as a unified district. We know that's not going to happen. All five towns at this point have said that can't happen. There's too much baggage. There's too many issues.
No, I want to interrupt again, Ruben. The towns have not said that.
Sorry.
Representatives on the Act 46 committee have said that.
Yeah. And that's a distinction that I called out earlier and then made badly. And I apologize.
I went to a lot of those meetings and I never left with much optimism as I walked out. I thought they were ugly.
Mm-hmm.
I was very upset when I left, and I finally said I can't go to them anymore. Mm-hmm. Because, and so it's hard for me. I mean, I would be hopeful that something that I didn't see as being as big a deal as other people, and I am a townsperson, but obviously it turned out to be a very big deal.
So I think to characterize my position, it's not optimistic as much as hopeful. I think that's a good way to put it.
So with the changes that have happened since town meeting, where we said that Berlin now has debt, is there any perception that that may have changed some of their position? Or is it potential that their representation doesn't represent the full board, their full board's opinion, and therefore if we do meet again as a committee, that there may be different representation from each town that may have a different position?
In my, directly, I don't think it matters.
They knew they were going to have
debt. We know what we want. And tonight, we don't know what anybody else wants, right? So we're here, we're getting input, we're saying, does this sound reasonable? Like, does this path that we're talking about make sense? And it sounds like yes. So I think that's part of the charge, is to find out if there is any change of heart. And I think what we're all hoping for is that whatever this group becomes or is, or however it sort of stands up, that it's, you know, if you want to come to the table, come to the table. Leave your baggage at the door. or don't, but we're going to have substantive conversations about this. I think it may, just by virtue of it being a voluntary group, instead of a 706B, thou shalt, that may actually, who knows? I don't know. Because I had my own kicks about the heavy-handedness of it, and it took me a while to come around. At the end of the day, we don't know, and I think that's really what we're hoping that we can find out with some representation.
Yeah. Just a quick observation. It seems like with the committee as it was working, that part of what held it up was the representational aspect of it. You know, individuals coming representing towns, but not necessarily representing the consensus of the school boards. And if you move forward to meet with the five towns, is it possible to call a large meeting where the boards get together rather than sending representatives? In other words, if you guys are sitting around the room all staring at each other, is that an opportunity to get a better sense of how the towns are feeling, as opposed to relying on representatives to act as the intermediaries?
We try to do that at the full board meeting, but because now it's gone back, the 706B has disbanded and there's no charge for the full board. You know, the full board is not a legal body that can decide for each of our towns. It's now back in each of our towns, so our only hope is to you know, do what we're saying, that, you know, have somebody represent and,
right,
and go there.
So are you prevented from inviting the other school boards to come sit in a meeting with you?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
No.
No.
That's kind of what my point is, that I think during this month, the local boards will be discussing how they feel, how they think they should move forward in interacting with their community, however they think is appropriate. That's why I think our next step is then to say, okay, everyone's met as a local board. This is what we felt as a local board. Mm-hmm. What do you feel like? And if there are others that feel the way we do, then we can work together as a group to generate one report and move forward. If no one else wants to do what we want to do, then our board gets together again and here's what the other board said, and it helps us inform. Until my position, I've talked against positions all night, but we don't know what the other boards think.
Right.
And before we can decide how to proceed, we need to know what the other boards think, not representatives, not
yes.
some people. What does the board think?
My suggestion to you would be if you thought it was the proper thing to do, that this board should take a formal vote on supporting a consolidation structure. And you could put that out as a press release to the town if you wanted the town to vote. I can't believe that if this board, especially if you had a unanimous vote going in one direction, that you would have the town not supporting the position that you came to. And that would give you strength going forward with the other.
And it would also demonstrate that that's something a board can do.
Right.
I think part of the problem is not all the boards are unanimous. I think and so there was a reluctance to take a board action, you know, and say this is what we believe. I think this could really help.
Mm-hmm. You really do need to know what the other boards think. And you
yeah.
Know
mm-hmm.
that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, for me, I'd like to know what more of our, not just our boards think, but our community mm-hmm. as well. I mean, you guys all seem very pro Act 46 merging, but in our last meeting, I can't remember.
Okay.
Yeah, he didn't, you know, so is there more Pauls out there that are strongly against, or right? Mm-hmm. Well, exactly. It's just mm-hmm. I wish we had more representatives.
Well,
here,
I think
I
we'd
guess.
Find out if we took a stance.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Right. That's
you
true.
Take a stance.
Right. Right. Versus
that's true.
Because if the stance we take is strongly not supported by the community, we'll hear that.
Yes, yeah. Indeed.
That is true.
So, I mean, from my perspective, we're elected officials. We're supposed to make decisions. That's why people have elected us, because collectively they can't make decisions. So let's make a damn decision, put it out, and it'll either be supported or it won't be supported. If it's supported, then we look to the other boards. How do you feel about this? Because if there's one thing my experience tells me on a school board, you tend not to hear a lot if people agree with it. If people disagree with it, you'll hear in no uncertain terms that they don't like that. The community doesn't like that, and you will hear that. So I think we take a position. This is how we feel.
Mm-hmm.
How does the community feel? We're going to ask, you know, and we could put it in an article or put it on Facebook. This is how the school board feels. This is our position. We're going to ask other boards how they feel and what their positions are. But you understand, as the East Montpelier community, how we're moving forward. How do you feel about that?
Mm-hmm.
Here's the contact information. You can contact the administrators. You can contact the central office. You can come to our next meeting, which is in a couple weeks.
Mm-hmm.
We can provide all kinds of avenues for input, if just so that the community can then respond to what we've said. I mean, that's what we do with a vote. We ask for input. We never know collectively how the whole community feels. We think, okay, this is our position. We think this is the way the budget should be, and the town lets us know if they support that or not.
Mm-hmm. There's a question.
As a community
member and parent, I would say that a lot of people, especially hearing a unanimous vote, are going to lean toward, wow, they know more about this issue than I do. They've been immersed in Act 46 and all the positives and negatives and read the efficiency reports, and they are is an element of members who are going to trust that. Of course, there will be some who don't, but I think many, you would have more buy-in by that statement. And when I think of the town's representatives who were against consolidating, they may or may not be representing the majority of their board, but they've been the liaison. Mm-hmm. So what that board has heard is a one-sided view for the most part. So they, I'm not as optimistic, but a strong person coming from a town against consolidating is going to be strongly convincing the people that they are around to think their way, unfortunately.
Although I would point out that when we dealt with the issue of the Australian ballot or town meeting vote for the budget, there were some very, very strong opinions, and that was a very, very electric meeting at U32, and I think the vote was overwhelming for what we have today. So one side did prevail pretty heavy on that.
On paper.
Tony, that first time when the very strong-minded people got up, they shot it down.
Yeah.
It was only when it was
quieter
and people had an opportunity to think for themselves that they voted it up.
And I wasn't there.
But it was in paper.
There was that little legislative doohickey thing.
Right.
Where they called the
vote. If I had been there.
Vote or something.
Yeah, he told me later how it could have been avoided.
Right.
Spur of the moment stuff, we didn't know what to do.
So before I forget,
yes,
I want to, again, on the record, and I want to support the letter that Jenny Burley put out on the front page forum, really thanking you and respecting you for all the hard work that you have done on this as a board. We feel very well, I feel very well represented by a group of really intelligent people.
Totally. And you were way more patient than either one of us ever could have been.
That's
correct. Well, we'll have to acknowledge Floor's patience continued at a better level than mine did at a certain point in the process. So she deserves even more credit for being continue to
both
work
that
forward.
Both deserve it. Yeah, it's a lot of work. So
okay,
teamwork.
So I have a pretty, I think we have a pretty clear sense of the room that we're strongly supportive of exploring this further. So the action item is to appoint board representative to act as a liaison with the other districts. I see Floor's hand shooting up.
Floor, I would like to interject
that
I was at meetings before and after Floor was chair, and Floor worked her heart out to make this work and to keep people civil and to engender respect between all the people. She is an amazing woman. I wish she lived in Calais.
Having said that, however, let's not forget that Stephen led it for a year and did a great job too.
Floor
just happened to be the right personality to try to make.
Let's just move forward.
Yes. This was a tough one all the way around, and it was hard to watch for everybody, I think.
But Ruben, before we vote on that, I'm in agreement. I'd like us to go on record of, and if I was going to word a motion, I might word it like the East Montpelier Elementary School Board favors, supports writing articles of agreement that would lead to consolidation. or would lead to a Washington Central supervisor, well, no, I can't say that, that would lead towards districts consolidating.
Consolidation, a consolidated district model.
Yeah. If there was a second, we could discuss that.
I'm just trying to get down what you said, Stephen, since I got put in this position.
Ruben was writing it.
Writing articles of agreement to support a consolidated district model. Is that right?
A consolidated district model.
Is Montpelier Elementary supports writing articles of agreement to support a consolidated district model?
That would lead toward a consolidated.
District model.
What are you imagining will happen with those articles?
I don't imagine that we might even write them. I'm just saying this is our current stance. If there are others to write them with, then if.
So should we?
If you want my basic gut opinion, the articles, if there's like-minded groups, the only article that takes any consideration is the debt one. The other articles can be written very quickly.
From a template.
The debt model would be unique. The debt article would be unique. What?
And the councils.
Councils aren't unique. Other people doing it. Anyone, I don't know of anyone that didn't support councils. That's fine. That's easy. It's still easy to write. No one wants to limit.
Can we add to this? Because I think one of the strongest points that everybody made today is that bring it to a vote to the Eastman Bureau that will lead to a consolidated district model to bring to a vote to our towns, or because that's something that we're not.
I wouldn't put it in the motion floor because we don't know where it's going to lead.
Okay.
We're making a statement. If we're the only ones that feel that way,
then it
won't go to a vote for the town because there's no reason for the town to vote because there's nothing that could change.
Right. And by statute,
if we're going to write articles of agreement to consolidate. It must go, well, actually it doesn't have to go to the voters, but I don't think we would even envision not sending it to the voters.
Okay.
My read of the current statute is it's now up to school boards to decide. Mm-hmm. I know in East Montpelier we wouldn't decide without the support of the town. Mm-hmm. I don't think any other towns would either. So we would progress the same way as if we were a 706B. We would write articles and the town would vote on them and say this is what they want to do. But I don't think it needs to be in the motion.
So the motion is the East Montpelier School Board supports writing articles of agreement that would lead toward a consolidated district model. I have a motion and a second, which means that we can discuss.
I don't need to discuss.
I'm not seeing any faces that look like they need to discuss.
I'm willing to wait if people are.
I don't need to discuss.
I think we did a lot of talking good.
So all of those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Abstains? Okay.
And we will support you.
And then are we going to take action on 2-1?
Yes. So 2-1.
Here's my recommendation. And it's just me.
Mm-hmm.
I do not think the representatives should be people that served on the Act 46 committee.
Why?
Because all this should be is there should be no advocating at all. It should just be gathering information. What do you think? How do you feel?
So
Anybody can do that. They need no knowledge of Act 46 whatsoever. All we're doing is saying, this is how we feel. How do you feel?
So what do you envision happening after that conversation? Do you think that then boards would pick representation or would pick a model or some group would pick?
I have no idea what would happen. But depending on who are picked as liaisons could influence the flow of information. And I want to facilitate the flow of information.
But But then if there's questions and...
What questions are there? How does your feel, this is how our board feels. How does your board feel? We don't want to know what individuals think. We want to know what a board collectively thinks. That's why my suggestion was, is at the chair level. The chair represents the board. And then when we hear, then to me, the next step would be if, regardless of how the boards felt, if there was a group of boards that wanted to go in a direction, then they would elect some, they would decide on some method of doing that, which it would be reasonable to think that there would be representatives assigned, liaisons, however you want to put it, to move forward.
So you as a board just voted mm-hmm. to support consolidation.
Yeah, we right. have a stance.
So you've taken a stance, each and every one of you board members. Mm-hmm. If you want somebody like that, you have to appoint somebody who's not on the board.
Yeah.
To play that role. But then that person needs to respect and represent what the board just voted.
But see, so what I'm saying is we're not at the stage where someone is representing our board. We're at the stage where we're telling the other boards how we stand and asking them what their stance is.
Do they want to play?
We have no liaisons yet because we don't know if we need liaisons.
So let me ask this question then. Are we then, what it almost sounds like to me is that we're tabling 2.1. No, that's not. It sounds like we could table 2.1 and I'm only saying this because I'm the chair, but I could pull the other, like we've made a clear statement. So then
right.
I can reach out, let me just see if I'm understanding. So then I would reach out to other board chairs, take a straw poll of what positions other boards have taken, and then what?
I'm just suggesting that the information is shared with the other boards and find out what the other boards' stances are. There's no negotiation, there's no liaising. It's, this is what we think, what do you think?
And that might encourage
and that informs
them to find out what their board thinks if they haven't done so yet.
I think everybody has.
And the only reason I say the board chair is because the board chair, in most instances, is the spokesperson for the board.
Yeah.
That's true.
And so board to board, it's chair to chair. It's not someone on the board. The board chair speaks for the board. You speak for us. You tell the other boards, this is our stance. This is what we voted on. How are you feeling about this? And the other board chairs representing their boards say, this is what our board thinks. That's
sure.
The only reason I'm logically
right.
The chair represents the board.
I am comfortable with that as long as that is as far as it goes. Because
I'm suggesting that's as far as it goes. As the board chair, right. you share the information with the other board chairs. They share with what they want to share with you. You come back at our next board meeting. I've told the other chairs, this is the information that I've gathered. What do we want to do? Because we're lucky we meet again this week. I mean,
so,
this month.
So here's how I suspect this would play out.
We do? We meet again?
Yeah.
This is a special meeting.
We meet again.
But I thought we changed that meeting to now. So we have the 24th.
We still have the regular meeting.
Yes.
Took that one off the calendar.
I don't think I've been invited.
Okay. So I think my suggestion then, if we want to follow this path, is that in our regular board chairs meeting, I will disclose that we've had this vote and we as a board voted unanimously to in support of writing articles of agreement. And that my suggestion to all of the boards would be to put the action item that we have on
on their next meeting agenda. And that the boards at that point appoint a representative to act as the liaison. And it seems to me, in my 12 and a half seconds of thinking about this, that walks that fine line of having it come from the appointed spokesperson of the board without tripping into the land of that which I'm not qualified to have an opinion on, which is pretty much anything to do with Act 46, because I have been a bystander, really. So that's where my hesitation is. I don't want to be in a position where I'm having any kind of substantive discussion around Act 46 or the machinations that have gone into it, because I have not been involved except very peripherally from the sidelines as a bystander.
That's why you're the right person to do it, because this is not a substantive conversation,
right.
It's just research.
I guess I'm just belaboring the point, really.
If that's the way we want to pursue, then we'd have to call a special board chairs meeting. We don't have a board chairs meeting scheduled until late May, maybe even early June.
So then I think my charge would be to see if we can do that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we can. We can propose that.
There's no other way you would.
We can propose it. I would suspect other board chairs would be willing to do that. I can't say that because of the governance structure that we're in.
But you know, how are you going to do it otherwise?
Of course.
We're going to do the same thing.
Reach out.
You would
it's at this point up to the local boards. A board chair could say our board doesn't want to do that, and they wouldn't have to be there.
Right.
I don't think that I think board chairs would be more than happy to have a special board chair meeting to discuss whatever would be on the agenda. So people understand there are some board chair meetings that are done collectively, and they're typically before a full board, and the board chairs build the agenda for the full board meeting. So
we have 2 weeks before our next meeting, and one of them is a school vacation week.
Right.
With that being said, do you think you could get the chairs meeting, or should you just reach out via email?
I'm actually inclined to just reach out to each of the individual chairs and get a sense of where they stand, whether they feel like we need a board chairs meeting, or if they would be willing to just put action item 2.1 on their next meeting agenda. Because if they are, then we don't need to have an entire meeting about it.
So my recollection of our last board meeting was that everyone had a meeting prior to school vacation. So they've already had this conversation.
It
or
is possible
all
that they're
week.
Having them tonight
or,
tonight,
or
Thursday
other
night,
nights.
Thursday, Wednesday night.
So what I will do is I will reach out to them all tomorrow. I'm going to put that on my calendar right this second. Pardon my looking down at a screen for a minute.
And while we have a lull, I would interject some hope in the whole process and why I'm encouraging what you're doing, Ruben. I would like to hope, if there's like-minded boards, that we still may be able to write articles of agreement, get it presented to the town, and shared with the state board in time to benefit from tax incentives.
Yeah.
It would be an incredibly tight fit, and it would be very hopeful thinking, but the possibility would exist.
Could I make a suggestion to go with that? That somebody put something out tonight, tomorrow, that screams this from the rooftop, what you voted on tonight? Because otherwise it's just gonna stay hidden. There's nobody that's gonna publish this.
Oh, well, I'm sure Floor will share it with Facebook Forum.
I'm hoping Floor will put it up.
Put it up on Frenchport Forum. I did put it on Frenchport Forum. I went out late.
I've got a whole press list if you need it.
Okay.
Do we have a whole press list that you can go to anymore?
Yeah, there's a...
Would it be helpful if those of us with contacts in other towns got it put on their front porch forums as well?
They can get it on all five.
They can get it
on all of them,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah, and I
this
think
may
be
an instance.
Important.
Go ahead.
Well, I think it would be important to let you put it out in Front Porch Forum, but also to let you have the conversations with the other boards.
I think this would be an instance where, for us to put the information in front of other towns, would not be good.
Yeah.
This is how we feel. We want the community members from East Montpelier to understand that.
Right.
I think we're overstepping our bounds and creating opportunities for friction if we're putting this out to other towns. That's the purview of that local town and their board to decide what information they want to share and how they want to share it.
Or the citizens of that town who see a post.
They're going to hear.
Share it,
all the towns are going to hear
us.
It. I just don't want to.
I would agree with.
I don't want to law. I don't want to make it look like we're lobbying to community members in other towns.
But just make sure our citizens hear it from you first, not
right.
Through Callis or through.
Well, I'm sure. I totally trust Floor.
Yeah, I'll put it out and I'll put out the.
That it'll get out at least in Facebook Forum very timely.
Yeah. Okay, so just to be clear, you're going to post it on Front Porch Forum.
Yeah.
Okay. Alrighty. Do we need further action? I think we don't need further action. I think we've got the beginnings, very, very beginnings,
mm-hmm.
of something that approaches a game plan.
That's it.
Okay. Thank you all for your input. We really
thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Good job.
Thank you.
And I'm going to adjourn us at...
No, it's an awkward thing.